Moving towards our next speaker and our next session, it's on internal audit as a tool for risk control and monitoring effectiveness. Let us put our hands together as I welcome on stage Ms. Archana Nigam, ICAS, Additional CGA, Ministry of Finance. Let's put our hands together for the lady who has an experience of more than 33 years in financial administration, has worked in almost all ministries of the Government of India, and is here to make sure that all of us are well aware of the subject and more. Let's put our hands together and welcome her.
Thank you very much. Good morning, everybody. Honorable Justice Radhakrishnan, Mr. Neeraj Kumar, Rohit, and everybody sitting here. It's indeed a very rare privilege for those of us in government to be actually addressing an August gathering largely from the corporate world. More so because the subject of our deliberations today is something that is not only topical, but is something which has been very, very close to my heart in my career of about 33 years, leading the work of internal audit as additional CGA in the Controller General of Accounts, Ministry of Finance, and also in the course of my developments of the accounts which are laid in Parliament for the Union. Clearly, therefore, this is something which, when you do audit, you have a certain perspective which while it does show you, as I was telling Rohit and another gentleman here, it does show you what is wrong. But at the same time, it also gives you that hope that should we be working towards it, we can actually do a lot to improve things. And may I say that today, with the kind of tools we have, I think this is the right time for us to reinvent ourselves in audit and to actually take it forward in a manner that that would take care of the very large plethora of programs that we run in this country and the size of this country. I've often felt the need for risk-based audit, and not merely that. I've often felt the need for rationalizing rules and codes that govern the processes of payments and collections of revenue in Government of India. And at the same time for reinventing and professionalizing the entire practice of internal audit. That being said, I would of course like to preface all my remarks by saying that what I say here is my personal opinion, because some of them tend to be strong opinions, so I believe as a serving bureaucrat, it is proper for me to say that what I say here is a matter of personal opinion and not the stand of Government of India. That having been said, these are very exciting times, as I said, and as my esteemed fellow speakers, Honorable Justice Radhakrishnan and Mr. Neeraj Kumar have stated, they have in fact already set the tone for the deliberations, which is that, listen, enough is enough, now is time for zero tolerance for fraud, and now is time for zero tolerance for misconduct. I will therefore, having no experience at all of either the corporates or of fraud, I will restrict myself very largely to the developments and the administrative reform that have followed in reinventing the practice of internal audit. I was reading up some papers from KPMG and their advisories, and I noticed that almost every country, particularly Australia, the UK, and the US, has this very large plethora of laws, very, very large plethora of laws, which talks about how you need to make to bring about greater effectiveness in monitoring. And I imagine that while those are possible and are urgently required even in our country, the fact of the matter is that, as we all know, a law by itself doesn't do very much. But the key thing is that the key objective of all of these laws, including the Sarbanes-Oxley Act, the Prevention of Corruption Act, and all of those other acts that have been implemented quite successfully in all of those countries, the key objective of all of these is the same. That is prevention, detection, and response. At a very conceptual level, that is how all of the internal auditors function. We try to prevent by way of forensic audit or other preventive audit. We try to detect, which I think is really an area for people other than us, it's probably the police, and detect fraud. Yes, we also detect fraud in very significant ways. And then, of course, we build our response strategies to mitigate those as best as we can. Effective fraud risk management, to my mind, provides an organization with tools to manage risk in a manner which is consistent with regulatory changes, such as we've seen, both by way of the Companies Act provisions and also the provisions of the Administrative Reforms Commission, which is very forward-looking. The second Administrative Reforms Commission, in its 14th report, is something that I would urge many internal auditors to go through to see how forward-looking government is. I am just trying to dispel the notion that we in government are not exactly Baba Adam ke zamane mein. We are pretty forward-looking now. And if you look at what has been said by the Administrative Reforms Commission, it's pretty much what has been said in the Companies Act, which is our regulatory framework for the companies, which in terms of Section 134, 177, and the Schedule 4, sets out the entire structure for audit becoming more empowered. And this happened as late as 2013. And you can imagine that if it's taken so many years for the companies in India to come under some kind of actual effective monitoring, then I imagine the fact that we are following so soon in 2014 with the administrative reforms is something that needs to be applauded. Governments are known to be lumbering. This government is not. This government is clearly on the go. And I think with the Prime Minister as we have him now, he's a man in a hurry. So I think all of us have to pull ourselves up by the bootstraps, whether we're working in the corporates or we're working in government. So these recent changes which affect the corporate world are essentially about setting up a board of director and having an audit board, an audit committee in the company in accordance with the terms of reference specified by the board. But above all, it's about the independent directors and the board satisfying themselves that the systems of risk management are robust and defensible. And that, I think, is the key. To go back to what my previous speaker said, and I think also to what Rohit said, although I think maybe, again, a strong statement like that shouldn't come from a bureaucrat like me, but the fact of the matter is that there has to be fear of death before something actually works. And you would see that in the provisions of the Companies Act, insofar as the Audit Committee and the functioning of the Audit Committee are concerned. It's unfortunate. Let's hope that we develop those social ecosystems and we develop those legal ecosystems. But as of now, it does appear to me that there's a fair case for that fear of death syndrome, whatever you might like to call it. Following that, we do have the Administrative Reforms Commission, which has also, among other things, been very forward-looking. And they have, for example, in their second Administrative Reforms Commission report, stated that that it is important that the audit committees are set up. They have asked for an office of chief internal auditor to a ministry or government of department of government be set up. And please bear in mind that almost everything I say will be in the context of ministries and departments of government of India, where I oversee the internal audit engagement as additional CGO for internal audit. So they have asked for a chief internal auditor to be set up to carry out the functions related to internal audit, and that the independence duties, the mechanisms for administration has to be tied up with the CAG and provided by statute. I've been in audit for the last 33 years of my career. Believe you me, empowerment of audit is so key. Audit without any teeth is so much of a waste of time and so very demoralizing for those of us who are into the audit practice. So the fact that the Administrative Reforms Commission talks about an independence, duties, time frame, and mechanisms for the administration of the Office of Chief Internal Auditor to be provided by statute is, to my mind, the best that could have happened. The standards for the internal audit to be done by these chief internal auditors in the ministries are to be developed by the CNHE. And the audit committee, much like that in the Companies Act, talks about chairman and two members who would be people of eminence from the public field. Therefore, I think it's important that, I think there are two key things which we have to understand. One, that this has led to what I would call the empowerment of the internal audit function, which, as I said, is important. And two, that there is this thing about working in tandem. Again, a strong statement, but I think something which is the truth, so I may say it without fear of consequence. The fact is that we in government do tend to work completely in silos. And if we are to work in silos, clearly then the fact that by statute we are now required to work in tandem with CAG is a great, great big thing. It's not enough that we do internal audit. It's also important that we do it in tandem with the CNAG. Let me just give you a brief about who we are. As internal auditors, we were created in 1978 in what was called the Indian Civil Account Service, to which I belong, and I'm from the first or second batches there. We were essentially mandated with preparing the accounts for the country, the Government of India Ministries, as well as being internal auditor. The Audit and Account Service now doing the accounting for the state, and the audit as external auditor. And that function of external auditor is obviously a very powerful mandate which they derive from the Constitution, Duties and Powers Act. We're not exactly there, and I don't think we should be, because the very mandate of external audit is different from that of internal audit. And I see the internal audit function having certain areas which to my mind are more relevant in a sense, because internal audit is here and now. And I say this from my experience of 33 years. I have now come to this maybe not very correct conclusion that an internal audit report which is here and now is perhaps better than an external audit report which comes 5 years later. Because enforcement of the CNAG's report has been something which has, over the period of many years, got diluted significantly. So if we are looking at internal audit as something which is concurrent, which is here and now, then obviously there is that advantage there. Let me also say that the key focus of internal audit always has to be in the context of government preventive audit, I think also in the corporates. But when we talk about preventive audit in government, that's a very, very big challenge. And we need to look at how we can actually do this, because it's important to my mind. The ideal vision that I would have is that when government devises, particularly in the social sector where I spent a large part of my career, almost 5 years as chief controller of accounts or the head of the accounts and internal audit for HRD. When you devise these schemes and these programs, the ideal vision is that the internal audit should be part of that platform there. Because as I've often heard say, you know, it's very easy for a CAG to come and say blah, blah, blah was not okay in post. Were they there when the program was being implemented? Did they tell us before we implemented the program as to what would be the risk? And therefore, the manner in which I'm taking forward internal audit and leading the work in the CGA is to say, yes, we are there. We are internal auditors, we are there. Please keep us on the same platform when you devise, let's say, the MNREGA or Sarv Shiksha Abhiyan or NRHM. Permit us to give you these those risk sanitization platforms where you can actually plug the risk before you launch the program. Because once you've had a launch of a program, as vast as it is in a country of this size, retracting fly-by-night operators, catching them, it doesn't really work out. I mean, even if you've caught a fly-by-night operator, what do? The money's gone. I mean, at the end of the day, the kind of monies we talk about in terms of outlays for all of such programs is so large that the preventive aspect takes on an entirely different meaning in the context of the very large canvas that government is. So we are doing things like that. And yes, I forgot to mention, the key thing about the ARC was the empowerment. It was the fact that we work in tandem with CAG. And the fact that the audit committees set up in the ministries to look after these matters will report to the parliamentary standing committees for those ministries. Just look at the kind of teeth that gives internal audit. Ultimately, the Public Accounts Committee and the Parliamentary Committees, Standing Committees, are the final karta dhartas of all that has to be done in terms of corrective action and in terms of bringing it to a platform where accountability can be sought. And so the ERC, in its wisdom, has already done that. We've taken this work forward in my office. We've issued guidance notes for all our ministries. We've also developed a generic audit manual where we are trying to professionalize the engagement process. Because clearly we are very short-staffed in offices like accounts and audit, that not having been a priority in government, again, permit the slightly irresponsible remark, but that's my experience. audit not having been a priority in government. It's a clear fact that we don't have enough people, and therefore it's important that we have standardization of processes. The point that I'm making, that the one that I keep telling all my officers is, hey, don't do 10 audits, do one good audit, on the basis of which I can issue a guidance note for similar ministries. And believe you me, in areas like the sectors of social development, if the kind of risks that you will find, whether they're financial risks or operational risks, will very often be similar from the NRHM to the MNREGA to the Sarv Shiksha Abhiyan to whatever, whatever. So that is important. And of course, the risk control framework that we want to develop is something that we are now taking forward. I was at a meeting with Sama, trying to learn how we could do risk control frameworks and how we could use data analytic tools and so on for that. And so that is something that we are now taking forward. I therefore feel that there's a lot of hope, and I feel that these are exciting times. And I think, to my mind, the key interactional takeaway or the interactional dialogue that I would like from something like this, from a conference like this, would be, how do we develop a comparable risk management framework across government, public-funded bodies, and the private corporates? I think that is very important. As I did say, can I get some water, please? As I did say right at the beginning, we are not in the Baba Adam mode anymore. We are pretty forward-looking in government. And therefore, I think there's a lot. Thank you so much, Rohit. There's a lot that can be, by way of mutual exchange, from both the government to the corporates. And from the corporates, I'm clearly learning already as to how corporates go about these things. It's only a matter of the canvas, and I think we can always figure it to that. And in that context, I'd like to share with you a use of IT for developing an accountability portal that I had done post my posting in HRD. Let me just share with you the trigger for which why this was required. As the chief of internal audit in HRD, there used to be obviously very large, humongous outlays that we were handling, and I would get these PILs, public interest litigations, from people saying, "Hey, you know, 65 years of independence, 40,000 crores on the budget. What's happening? Why aren't there schools on the ground? Why isn't there a sanitation facility, health facility, blah, 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 blah?" And so I thought about it and I said, a country this large, and I'd also seen what happens in ministries, the key social sector ministries. See, sitting here in Delhi, and that is something which separately you would need to appreciate, that the constitution is drafted in such a way that the funds are here and the schedules by which the implementation of social policies is to be done is the mandated responsibility of the states. That being the case, I, for me, for a moment, couldn't fathom how anybody sitting here can actually, you know, validate whether the service provider sitting in Balia or Basti or wherever actually has the ability to perform. I mean, clearly he doesn't. Nobody is actually validating that. Nobody is doing forensic audit on that. So I began this forensic audit work there and took it forward to develop what is now called CPSMS, the Central Plan Schemes Monitoring System, available at www.cpsms.nic.in. If you get a chance, please look at it. It's an amazing, amazing portal, which started as an accountability portal with the five stated objectives which I had of online tracking of every release made under the plan schemes, the central sector plan scheme. Tracking, monitoring, online, real time, every single money that went out from my pay and accounts offices of the ministries here to the last end of the beneficiary, which might be the baildar of MNREGA. And that was saying something, because the kind of granularity that we needed to build up was something which has taken us a long time. We have, however, done that. And I say, so that was one of the objectives. The second was obviously bringing up transparency in the idling of funds. You know, when you go to the parliament, you say, ha ha, give me so many funds, I'm going to build so many schools. And then we found when we were developing this portal that a lot of money just lies around in banks. That's not what it was taken out for. I'm sorry. Money lying in the banks does not equate to a school on the ground. Certainly money lying in the does not mean there's a health or sanitation facility in the village. A lot of money we found was lying around idling in the banks, which we, which obviously meant also, as a finance person, for me it meant that cash management was so poor. When we went to the finance minister with this product, we said that we think there's about 50,000 crores idling in the banks, and he said it would be much more. Mr. Chidambaram in 2007-08, when I developed this, said it would be much more. And he was correct. It was close to 85,000 crores. Idling at various levels of banks. There are about 12 levels through which money passes, and clearly that was not correct. So we needed to correct that. So reducing float, better cash management was the other objective. Efficient fund transfer, but of course, if you're doing electronic transfers, there's nobody sitting there to take their little power out of it at the state level, at the block level, at the village level, at the whatever, whatever, whatever level. Right here, straight to the bank. And in a sense, this is a Picasso of what is now happening. Today, of course, the PFMS, as it is now called, has become a very large public fund management system, which not only has a database of all schemes of Government of India, and not just the plan scheme, every single scheme. It also has a database of service providers, which is something like 17 lakh service providers are on the database. It has a link with every single public sector bank, that's 27, and almost 1 lakh branches that we use through their core banking. And it has also a link with RBI, because in many cases, funds are transferred under certain schemes directly to the state. And finally, over a period of the last 5 or 6 years, we've also developed through our IT processes of SFTP servers, we've also processed it to integration with every single treasury of every single state government of this country. And clearly, therefore, we are now moving it in my office, in the office of CGA, we are moving it on to develop what is called an IFMIS, an Integrated Financial Management Information System, which we hope will be the future for much better financial management. And to my mind, any transparency in financial transactions is, I am not here to detect fraud, but certainly to my mind, this is something which gives a handle to a lot of people to say, hey, listen, there's fraud here. So that is what we are now working on. We are engaged in the office of CGA. We're looking at what we did in Brazil. And actually, I had modeled the CPSMS on a scheme called the Bolsa Familia in Brazil. As you know, Brazil is 2.5 times the size of India. And I felt that if they can do it there, why can't we do it here? And the Bolsa Familia was actually responsible for the president to have come back, winning the election, and also reduce their poverty, the people below the poverty line. But what excited me most about Bolsa Familia is something that I'm hoping we'll do with the CPSMS portal, which is to put all of this into the public domain, and then to let it be used for social audit. As Rohit said, just let me know when I have to stop. As Rohit said, there is a lot of aspiring people at the village level. Just think about it. If all of these figures are available at the bottom, at the village, here this man who doesn't even know ki village ke school ko banne ke liye kitna paisa aana tha. Wo to chhodiye, main apne batchmates se baat karti, principal secretaries Maharashtra, and he would say, yaar wo paisa to aata hai, pata nahi hota hai kis scheme mein aaya hai. Now we've mapped everything. So now the chap knows ki school banne ke liye tumhare gaon mein itna paisa aaya. All that you need to do is to put up on blackboard and say, paisa itna aaya hai, so that people can ask questions. If I don't know how much money has come, how will I ask you, paise ka ho kya raha hai? And so that, I think, is something that I would love to do. Hopefully, we will soon move to moving this into the public domain. And then I see a very exciting future for social audit, a very largely unused platform in this country. There have been social auditors, but at the end of the day, I've seen social auditors getting as equally sold as media does. So at one point of time, and I'm sorry for these strong statements, but to my mind, the only thing that works is everybody being into it. Everybody, meaning everybody, not 2 or 3 social auditors, or maybe 10 or 20 or 100 or 200 or whatever many there are today. It needs everybody to be able to say, hey, this is wrong. So that, I think, is something that we need to do. And I think we must stop with that now, because this is something that has already taken more time than I should have. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you so very much for joining us, ma'am. In fact, for sharing the internal audit procedures with us, since we are a little short on time, I'd like to thank you now. And may I request Ms. Dhar to please join us on stage and let us capture this special moment. Let's put our hands together for her. Of course, she'll be there with us through the day, so we're more than welcome to take questions one-on-one a little later.